Hey, it's Mark Pattison back again with another great episode of Finding Your Summit. And what we try to do, just as a reminder, is to find people who have overcome adversity and found their way. And this week is another great example of a guy who has done that. His name is Cory Porcter. And Cory is a great dude, and you're going to really sense that and feel that from this radio podcast. The first thing is he grew up in Washington, and I am from Seattle. He grew up down the street, so to speak, in Gig Harbor, then went on to play football at Montana, University of Montana, before going on into the NFL, enjoying a 7-year career, mostly with the Dallas Cowboys. Cory is a big dude. He played on the offensive line. And I think he's about 6'4", 6'5", you know, close to probably 300 when he was playing at his peak. And he's a guy that I met down in Tanzania through the Waterboy Foundation that Chris Long invited former NFL players and Green Berets on. We really bonded when we were down there. And Cory tells his story. And again, everybody's situation is relevant to their own. And so you might look at an NFL guy and say, hey, you know, why does this guy have any problems? Well, you know, Cory is a big guy. He was all state, but didn't get recruited by any of the big schools like Washington, USC, UCLA, so on. He went to the smaller school. And then when he came out of that, after winning a national championship at that, you know, lower D1 level, he did not get invited to the combines, and he did not get drafted in the NFL. So again, it's a setback. It's frustrating. You work everything towards that goal, and then it doesn't happen. And so he talks about how he constantly had to overcome that, going through injury. And then the worst thing of all is really dealing with the pain, the loss of his nephew, his brother's son, who died when he was a small kid, and what that meant to him. And another thing that we really talk about a lot is this whole idea of grit. And Cory is a gleaming example of what grit is all about. I just, you know, love talking to this guy. I mean, here is a guy that we were on the top of Kilimanjaro and with these other NFL players, and he lost vision in one of his eyes. He just got delirious from the altitude that we were at, 19,333 feet, and we were up there way too long. And it just really had to dig deep to get up that mountain, and took my lead, took Jim Moore's lead, and we got him down safe and sound. But, you know, just in life, you know, things that we all have to go through, and when grit really kicks in and how you get that. So, as always, we love the reviews, ratings. Please go in. It's really helping me off. And I can tell you guys, these podcasts are blowing up. It's amazing. And I have a lot of great guests on. There's a lot more coming, but it's because of you that it's making this thing super fun for me to watch grow. And let's keep it going. Okay. So on that note, let's get on to Cory. All right, here we go. Hey, everybody, it's Mark Pattison back again with another great episode of Finding Your Summit. And I'm really stoked this week because I've got a fellow NFL player that I met on this NFL fundraising Waterboy project that we did together down in Kilimanjaro, down in Tanzania. His name is Cory Porcter. He played 5 years in the NFL and actually is a fellow Washingtonian, which I'm excited to speak to. So, today I'm broadcasting live from Hermosa Beach, California, and Cory is in Fort Worth, Texas. Cory, how are you doing?
I'm good. What's going on? You're Hermosa Beach,
Hermosa,
over there?
Yeah, you know, I'm about 100 yards off the water. You know, if I get a little stressed out, just walk down and jump in, and, you know, dolphins swim by, and we have to do kind of a high five thing, and then I come back and jump on my work day. It's great.
That stuff's good for the soul, man.
It's great for the soul. I tell you what, speaking of the soul, and we'll jump into this really quickly, but I know that the great state of Texas was affected in a big time way with Hurricane Harvey. And we were just talking about that before we went on air here. And you were just talking about the effects. It did not actually come into Dallas-Fort Worth, but you certainly saw the remnants of people coming up in a panic and trying to buy boats and stuff like that, right?
Yeah. I mean, kind of the extent of weather that we got was a couple monsoon, short monsoon rains, right? And it wasn't, so it lasted for a flash of a day and it got out of there for us. So the direct effect that we saw anywhere in the DFW Metroplex, we're about 4 hours north of Houston, is all of a sudden, it was really cool to see, all of a sudden you saw convoys of people with boats. I mean, people on Facebook buying up boats, looking for boats to buy left and right, gathering trailers of supplies, you know, diapers and hygiene kits and whatnot, and just going on tirades down there. My buddy, it was great to see what everybody was doing. My buddy Casey Donahue, who's a big country singer here, committed a whole week's worth of his shows. They had a Dallas show downtown, and his wife just gathered. I think they had three trailers full of stuff that they took down to rally points down there. Yeah, and it was just, that's just one example.
No, it's great. And a lot of what we're talking about here on this podcast is about overcoming adversity, and we'll get into some of the stuff that you've gone through. But, you know, it sounds like from a bird's eye view, you were able to watch a community come together, join, and create kind of a bigger cause around trying to help those in need, which is so important, right? I mean, it was just amazing to see those visuals on TV and, you know, water lines up 10 feet and going in homes and cars upside down and people in boats literally going down streets, you know? So it's just insane.
It's nuts, because that in itself, the hurricane is one massive incident. And then it kind of leads way to other opportunists or, you know, some bad people that want to take advantage of the situation. And I had a friend down there that, you know, the local deputy department asked them to mount up, gear up, and take their guns and try to help find a shooter that was in a flooded neighborhood. I mean, just people taking advantage of the situation. So it's awesome to see. And those want to overshadow the light, which it doesn't happen, right? But those good people really, they bring out the best. I mean, I saw, you know, there was one report of a guy who had his son in an apartment building, had to escape through the second level apartments. And he's walking out with a backpack and his son, and he's talking about how blessed he is and how thankful he is just to be out. And, you know, you kind of look at that situation, like, how can you not be ticked off or distraught or upset at the situation? And the guy's like, no, man, I'm thankful. I got my son and I got my own 2 feet to walk on.
What you're talking about is perspective. Right. And I think so often we get caught up on our own, you know, minutiae of what we think is important. And if you just take a step back, go up to 30,000 feet and look around, there's always people with much worse situations. So, you know, would you rather have a child that was killed in a flood, or would you rather have saved that child and you're alive and you have everything and you have to rebuild? But, you know, family is everything. Life is precious.
Yeah. It's huge.
So, okay. So let's go back and let's kind of roll up to how you got to where you are today. And, I talked about in the opening, you're from Gig Harbor, Washington, which is about an hour away from Seattle. You grew up there, and some things that, struck me kind of odd, you know, as I was kind of reviewing your bio and, you know, some of the things that we got to know each other when we were down in Tanzania, last February, was that you were All-State in high school playing football. You're a big guy. So for people that don't know, Corey is, what's your size? I mean, you're what, 6'6", 6'5"?
Well, I wish I was that tall. I'm 6'4".
6'4"?
6'4", about 280 right now. About 320 when I was playing.
Yeah, so you're a big boy. So you did well. And the thing that, and this streams down to the NFL as well, but it was odd to me that it's hard to find big bodies like you. And not to say that this is a jab or anything, but you ended up going to the University of Montana in Missoula, which is awesome. But I was surprised that, you know, more or bigger schools weren't coming after you, like the University of Washington, the UW.
That stuff is interesting, because I did at first. I had a whole lot of Division I interest my junior year. So I performed really well. We were about 5-5 as a team, and athletically was doing really well. I was leaned out to about 250, 240 in that season, and actually had an early offer from BYU in the spring, which was really cool. And then senior year, I had torn my meniscus, which you know is not much, right? That's an easy thing to come back from. And I tore my meniscus, and I remember after the first game, that Monday after the first game, I pulled it back to stretch my quad, and it popped into my joint. And so I couldn't straighten my leg all of a sudden. It's just kind of funny. So, okay, all right, now I can't straighten my leg. Now we have to go get it scoped. And I'm out for the next 3 weeks when, you know, at the time, this is huge to me because I don't know any different, right, than being healthy. And so I'm like, oh my gosh, I got to have surgery. It's going to be crazy. I'm only out for 3 weeks. I come back and end up playing full time. I'm about a step slower than what I should have been at that point in the season. And a lot of that 1A interest dropped off, which is funny. It's because they were scared off from a torn meniscus.
Yeah. Well, you know, those scholarships are precious. And at the end of the day, it trickles back to the head coach, and it's all about wins and losses. So they want to try to bring in the horses that are going to get them to the finish line. And that's just, it's just always a tricky thing, you know, and that's the whole magic of some guys to that can see through that, and others just see what they can see.
Mm-hmm. Well, and some, I had one team that offered me, one 1A team, that was University of Idaho when Tom Cable was the head coach there. And they saw through that, and he was really great through that whole situation. And he thought I was going to commit to BYU when I was on my visit. So he went ahead and offered some other linemen, which is no big deal, but it kind of put them in a little bit of a bind. And then they offered to gray shirt me. And I mean, he put it in writing and everything because BYU kind of jerked me around a little bit. And I didn't like it because they weren't up front with where they, because they offered early, then they were never up front with where they were on that offer, right? If they were going to honor it or just pull it back or go a different direction. And I mean, right up, I remember my mom really wanted me to go there, had me check the week of signing and wanted me to double check with them. And same thing. He's like, well, as of right now, you didn't. And that was the switch between Gary Croton and Lavelle Edwards, who's a big, big name there, right? It was
coached there forever, right? Like 30, 40 years, it seemed like. But, you know, that's just, so goes the drama of high school recruiting, and a lot of people have been through it. But again, it's all about what you do about that and how you move forward. And so you end up then getting an offer to go play for the University of Montana, which is a D1 school, but AA. Is that how they say that?
They changed the affiliate, or they changed the actual name to what, the sub championship series, something like that. Some crazy, I don't know why they do that, but it's 1AA football. It's a step below.
Well, you had a great career there. You played pretty much all 4 years, and you guys ended up winning the championship, which the championship of anything is amazing to achieve, right? And so was that your sophomore year or your junior year?
My freshman year.
Your freshman year.
So freshman year, I started 5 games at right tackle. John Skinner had gone down and moved around a bunch, and then we ended up winning. And get this, we were the winningest team in NCAA history at 16-1, because we lost to Hawaii, who was our second game of the season, but we ended up going 16-1. And I mean, that's a full professional season.
Yep.
And win the title. We beat Furman. I don't remember what the score was, but beat them sophomore year, junior year. We didn't make it back. I think we made the quarter and semifinals or something there. And then senior year, lost in the finals. We were smoking hot on offense and just couldn't cap it off.
Yeah, my freshman year, so I got a scholarship to the University of Washington. And my first year there, we went to the Rose Bowl. And then my sophomore year, we went to the Rose Bowl. And I'm like, oh, this is just the way it is, man. You go to the Rose Bowl every year. And then anyway, so we ended up going to great bowl games, you know, from there on out. But I mean, when you get caught up that early in that kind of success, you think it's just going to be, you know, in perpetuity. And so I'm not sure which is better, to kind of set the bar high and then constantly try to get back to that pinnacle, or have adversity earlier in your career so you know where you want to be. But, you know, at the end of the day, you won the championship, and winning anything anywhere is an amazing accomplishment. So, okay, so now you have a great career there. You're in Missoula, and now you're prepping for the draft, and you end up going where?
To prepare for the draft, I went to Tom Shaw, who was in Kenner, Louisiana, right outside of New Orleans.
Yep.
And he was the speed coach of the Patriots at the time. I'm not sure if he still is. But this was before Hurricane Katrina and all that stuff, which ended up moving him. But I was there. I'm with a whole different level of athletes now, right? Because I'm used to being kind of the big fish in the pond, or at least one of the top guys all the time, to a mess of prospects that I have no idea who they are. But a lot of them are draft picks. A lot of them are going to the combine. I wasn't one of those guys. I was there trying to get my 225 bench up, which was not a natural strength for me, and try to get me running well, and so I can get some numbers that might be impressive to put me on the draft board for a lot of people.
Yep.
And it was a great experience. A great experience because I got a lot of great work on. Definitely got stronger and faster, and was able to get a step in those measurables, and really put on some weight. I was 305 when I came out of there, and they really liked that. They wanted me above 300. But, you know, wasn't enough to get drafted, but enough to get some interest. So I ended up going to Detroit from there, undrafted.
Well, look, I went to a big school, and I did fairly well there, and ended up getting drafted in the seventh round. And I remember going through the combines and doing all that stuff myself. And I always had that mindset of, you know, just hope for the best and expect the worst, right? And versus so many people, if they're not drafted, you know, where they want to be or where they think they should be, which, you know, you always think your kid's the most beautiful kid on the block, right? And so it's that same mentality of, you know, now it's the first round, the second round, the third round, and now it's this massive disappointment. And I was so grateful just to be drafted. And I didn't know where that was going to be to who. In my case, it turned out to be the Raiders. But, you know, I mean, I was ecstatic. You know, I was high-fiving, and our common buddy Jim Mora, he was there when all that happened. And you know, it was just a blessed moment. But, you know, I think for anybody, it doesn't really matter, really. First, second, third round, maybe. Everybody else, you're out there battling. So, I mean, okay, so you go to Detroit and you're there. And then how do you end up in the Cowboys? Because Cowboys, it seems like that was really the meat of your career.
That was, and that stuff's funny too, right? You know how fast something can change in the league.
Yep.
And it's, you get settled one spot and it's a change in the blink of an eye. And so anyways, I was there in Detroit most of my rookie year, and we lost to Atlanta on Thanksgiving, got smoked. And that was when Coach Mora killed us, when he was the head coach of Atlanta.
Yep.
And Steve Mariucci was the head coach there, and I loved him. I think a lot of guys just took advantage, and we had a tough team, tough go at that. But anyways, the next Tuesday night, after that coaching change was happening, 9 p.m., I'm at Chris Chelios' place, and he was captain of the Red Wings at the time. We're at his restaurant with some friends. At 9 p.m., I get a call from my agents, Don Yee. He says, hey, Cowboys want to pick you up at the last five games of the season. So all of a sudden, I got to go back, pack up my apartment, which I barely had anything anyways, but pack up the apartment and get on a 6 a.m. flight to be at practice at 10.
Yeah, no, I've gone through that. And so I think what a lot of the listeners don't understand, because most people haven't been through this, is that when you open up the paper and you see transactions and you see guys, you know, hey, he got cut, he got traded, they don't understand the impact it has on your life. So for a full year, more or less, you've been in Detroit. In my case, it was in L.A., and you've gone through training camps, you've got alliances, you've got buddies, you've got utility bills, you've got your car there, you've got other things going on, you have a life going on. And then, like you said, you know, like within hours, you get a phone call and everything changes and you have to be someplace else, you know, like within 24 hours. And you're like, what? And so you're in this like mad scramble to make all that happen. And it's just it's really, you know, disrupting. And obviously, you know, change is always hard for anybody, but it's stressful, it's hard, and, you know, you take a big deep breath and, okay, let's go. Now, in your case, Dallas was a great place to go. I mean, it wasn't like you were being sent off to Buffalo or someplace. I mean, you were going to a good spot. So tell me about your experience with the Cowboys.
I got there, Bill Parcells is the head coach, and I liked him right away. And to me, I liked it because I came in. Bill Parcells is a workhorse guy. He brings in these guys that like to work, and not a knock on any of my previous teams, but I went from Detroit at the time. I was one of a handful of guys on the team who were regularly in the weight room, who liked working out, liked doing that stuff. Right, Cory Schlesinger was one of those guys there at the fullback, But when I got to Dallas, I was one of the whole team. Right now, he made some of that stuff mandatory to get three lifts in a week. This and that for off-season workouts were mandatory. But I became one of a team of guys who wanted to be there. And that, and you have a different kind of character mold when you show up to a team like that. So all of a sudden, I came into a whole lot of guys that like to work, who are good players, who are tough. And that elevated my game quite a bit because I needed that. I needed a growing phase in Detroit, and I got there. And I needed to, all of a sudden, I'm practicing against Greg Ellis and practicing with guys like at the time, at that first year was Flozell Adams and Andre Girard and Kyle Kozier and Mark Rivera. Mark Colombo was new there. And then Leonard Davis came later. But we just had some excellent workers, strong guys, tough mentalities that liked to go, to play.
You know, one of the things I always found was, it was always surprising for me that you would think that this is the top of the top that have made these NFL teams, right? In terms of percentage. And you would think that all these people are self-driven, that every day they're running stairs, they're running sprints, they're in the weight room, they're doing all those things. And what I found, there's only about 10% of those guys in that locker room and all the locker rooms I've ever been in that, you know, just had that natural drive. They were talented and there was motivation, but they weren't self-driven. And that's okay. But you needed that program, that leadership in place to make sure those things were happening, because if you didn't, you know, people would slack off and, you know, not push themselves in the way that they need to be pushed. But, you know, if you want to be around successful people or be successful yourself, you have to hang out with successful people and create successful programs to do that, right? And that's what it sounds like Parcells did for you and your teammates.
I love the phrase. Your destiny is directly tied to the crowd you hang around.
Yeah. Love that.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's, you can't be, and I don't remember the coach that said it, you want to be a top Division 1A coach, right? You can't be hanging around your old buddies back in high school that aren't doing anything.
No.
Right? I got to get around people who are going to elevate my game. And I love that because it is. So all of a sudden I get around this different crowd where I was one of, you know, a handful of workers who like to do that, to now a bunch of guys. These are my kind of guys that all of a sudden I'm jacked. I'm great. And so the whole elevation, that whole team atmosphere was completely different. And it doesn't make the games any easier, but it makes the overall atmosphere of that team a whole lot better, right? You take your losses are more impactful and it refocuses those guys a whole lot more. But I loved it because I got around guys like Mark Colombo, who's a close friend of mine, and those guys, you know, from Boston College. He was a first-round draft pick to Chicago, had a terrible knee injury. Parcells took a chance on him, developed Joe Jurassic, developed him in the weight room, got him jumping again and doing all kinds of good plyo stuff, and he's tough as hell, you know. Those are the guys that made you want to fight.
Yeah, no, it's
all of a sudden picking fights on the field and you're jumping in the pile.
Yeah, no, so. I've been around those guys. That's great. I love it. So you're in Dallas for 5 years. Is that right?
5 years. End of 05, 2006, 7, 8, and 9. I started primarily as a swing guard center, special teams guys, wedge, you know, field goal, PAT. And then I started most of 2008. At left guard, a couple games for Andre Girard, 2007. But 2008 was really up and down, had a great time. It was, the whole team was, we kind of fluctuated a little bit in what we did. Wade Phillips was the new head coach then, and he was a great guy in just putting pieces together. He's kind of a puzzle master, right?
Yeah.
Because he'd put DeMarcus Ware in some optimal positions and knew how to really piece those guys together. And that's when Jason Garrett came in as the offensive coordinator also, and really started putting his own flavor in some different things. And we ran ISO. I remember as an offense, we ran ISO down everybody's throat all year long, all season long. And that was really good because I played some excellent games, ran into some adversity too myself, where I had some tough games, right? I was always the guy who's kind of like average sized, light in the ass is what they always called me, right? I got these skinny legs.
Yep.
And so, you know, I was a guy watching film. I remember for a Washington game, it was the last season in Texas Stadium. and Griffin, who was a D tackle with Washington at the time. And I remember coming out that first play of the game. I think we had 133 called, which is a slide protection, right, where the center's moving right. And I got a one-on-one right on the three. We're expecting an over this whole game, and I get an under right out the gate and a one-on-one out the gate, play action pass. And all I'm thinking is, holy crap, this guy's way bigger in person than he looked on film. And I got to punch the ever-living hell out of him to make a statement right now. And that would get me in trouble at times, right? Because I'd go try to smack the hell out of you, and you'd give me a big ole, and I'd whiff sometimes, and that was okay. I could recover, but I had to bring a whole lot of attitude to the table to stick around. That's for sure.
Yeah. Well, for everybody that doesn't have any clue what Corey just said, it basically means Corey lined up against an elephant, and this elephant was way bigger than him, and he got around him, and so he had to recover from that. So, okay, so you're in Dallas, and then what I want to set up this kind of life after football and what goes on, because what I think a lot of people don't understand is that, you know, and I was in the same way where, you know, in high school, you're going to high school, you're going to school, and, you know, you're playing football and everything is going great. And then from there you go to, in your case, University of Montana, and you're there 4 or 5 years, you're having a great time, you're playing football, you're continuing to, you know, work your body year round and build on your craft. And then you go into the NFL, and now you go from Detroit and from Detroit to Dallas for 5 years. And then you end your career in Miami. You know, the whole time you're just always trying to get better, but you don't know if you're going to be cut, if you're here and there's stress, but then one day it happens. And well, just like me, one day they throw you out, and, you know, and you're sitting there, like you're looking around, and all the noise stops. And you're going, okay, wait a minute, is this it? And that transition is so difficult, because unlike everybody else, all my other buddies who were working normal jobs that were building into a career, you kind of go off the cliff. We all do, right? So what was that like for you when the music stopped?
It was weird for me, because it was almost a fade out in a sense. It stopped right away for me. So I was in Miami and ruptured my patella tendon in my left knee on Thursday night game against the Bears. I think Urlacher was laughing because I screamed like a little girl when it happened, because it was awful. But I was hurt, and from there, my knee got infected, 5 surgeries later. At no point did I ever think I was done playing, right? That whole time, that whole next year I spent on the couch, it sucked. It was during the lockout, so they weren't necessarily privy to me, all that information out there. But I fully expected being out, getting strong, and getting back with the team. And all of a sudden, you know, I had some opportunities, had some tryouts, but I had this long list of surgeries. So now I had an injury, I had a list of surgeries that I've just gone through. This guy's knee was infected, so it's, you know, it's not quite as stable as it could be, right? And I'm going into my 7th year, which brought like almost $1 million minimum price tag. And there's younger guys who are healthier that we want to get looks at to try to develop, right? And that's just the reality of the game in that sense. And so I had some, so it reached a point where, okay, I keep the door open, but we got to start taking steps for our own life. But it hit a point, there was a point in time there where, you know, I'm stuck on Percocet and Vicodin and loving the pain pills, because it took me out of this
reality
world. Yeah. It took me out of facing that. Mm-hmm. And that was hard. And thank God for my wife, Megan, because she was there for me to lean on pretty heavy. And I didn't even realize it at the time, but she's thankful for that time. And I am too now looking back, but she was thankful for that time because I was so headstrong on taking care of the world myself and I can fix everything, that I didn't give her anything. Right. Mm. I didn't let her support our relationship, and we were engaged at the time. And when that happened and I was forced to sit on the couch literally for a year, I had to rely on everything for her. You know, she had to help me tape my leg up. I'm sitting there. I remember the first couple weeks after the first surgery, you know, I'm taking a shower every other day, every third day, and she's got to help me in the shower, for crying out loud. I mean, that's humbling. Right. You go completely independent for this long, and all of a sudden somebody's got to sit there and help get you undressed, and I could wash myself, but it's a hard thing to move through.
Well, what I've learned from personal experience is, and this took me a long time, because just like you, you're headstrong, you've always, done well for yourself, and it's kind of the NFL mentality, but what we all need is to reach out for help. And, I think the sooner that we realize that we can't do it ourselves, and that there's so many wonderful people out there actually willing to help you and want to be there for you, you just got to ask, right? They'll come running. And those are the true friends, and those are the true mentors, and those are the type of people that, I think we all need to be around.
And a lot of times people are asking to help. You just won't receive it.
That's right.
Right? I mean, how many times have you've told somebody, hey, what can I do? What can I do for you? Can I bring a meal? Simple as a meal or a conversation. And it's almost our natural reaction is, no, I got it. Especially guys, right? Especially men who are raised up in this sport, who's given you so many great values, and they're all so great. But one of those that can be a side effect of that is that natural independence or mindset that I can control everything. I just need to do this. I got it. I need to get back to work. I need to work harder. These are the things I need to figure out, instead of listening to my coach or listening to a teammate and let them breathe some advice on you or ask some questions that might expand your thought pattern a little bit.
Yeah. So how did you get over that? So you're sitting on the couch, you're finally letting your wife, you had to, no choice, or your fiance at the time, help you get through that. What were the things that, you finally got over that hump and you knew that you weren't going back to football, and now you're plotting your course ahead?
People. 100%, because I'm still set on this. And to me, we decided, we were in Texas, still living in Irving, Texas at the time, DFW Metroplex. At the time, got introduced to Joe Carini, who was a powerlifter strength trainer who dealt with Tiki Barber, Lawrence Taylor, LT, who was a running back out of TCU, who was in San Diego for a long time.
Tomlinson.
Yes, Tomlinson, Danny Tomlinson, him. So he dealt with some really good players. And so anyways, got hooked up with him and decided to go to New Jersey to train. And ultimately, the football goal wasn't reached, where we didn't get on another team. But I had some people put in my life then that were needed hard. I mean, Megan and I needed each other, but we're both looking for answers in this situation. She's trying to support me to get back to the game. And we were put in, and we're in New Jersey, and I met Joe, who was this guy. Just, he fed my desire to want to work, right? And so we got big, we got strong, ate a crazy, and then we made some other friends, a chiropractor in New Jersey, the Teresa family, and then their extended family, Aiello's, and then more family on top of that. And I know, I'm sure anyone who's dealt with this, the Italian culture, right, or Sicilian culture, those people, once you're in, accepted into their family, love you to death.
You're part
you
of the
could kill
you,
somebody,
baby.
Right? You kill people and you're still, I love them. Yep. No, that wasn't him, right?
No, I got it.
And excuse me, but those people, they lifted me up in a time that I needed it big time. And it was like, I'm forever, because they're super close friends of us still, and we love them. They're family to us. I mean, they give, those were people that were crying when we decided to move back to Texas, and we're crying to separate from, because we're going to miss them so much.
Yeah.
Right. And that was just, that was us. That gave us the strength to take a next step in our life for ourselves. That's what that allowed us to do. And that was so huge. I mean, even after football, you think you've reached this kind of pinnacle of grit and performance and sustainability, or I got this in this world. After that was when I needed people to support me the most, and they did.
Well, I think one of the things that I learned that I don't think things just happen randomly. I don't believe in, just what a coincidence, I just happened to do this. I think in order for you to actually make those kind of profound steps, you need to put yourself out there, and then these types of things will come into your life. Right. So you got to be open, like you said, open mindset,
and then actually take those things that are going to get you out there. Staying in your house on the couch is not going to get you anywhere, right? And so until you're willing and ready to like put it out there and really open yourself up, I think that's when the transformational change really comes into your life. So you made it out. So what I want to do is, Cory, so I appreciate you sharing that. And I want to talk about something that I saw out of you, and I've heard you speak about this subject, but it really was like on my mind when I was thinking about this podcast with you. And I want to set this up a little bit. So Chris Long started a foundation called Waterboys, and what Waterboys is raising money through former or current NFL players. And then it funds wells down for the Maasai people in the Serengeti in Africa, specifically in Tanzania. And so Chris had put together I think there were six former NFL guys, along with Chris, Jim Mora, head coach of the UCLA football team, and three or four ex-Green Berets, Marines, that we all, you know, converged in on this hotel in this small town called Arusha. And so this is where I met Cory. And so we went out and we went to the different tribes and we had a great time. And then ultimately we ended up going to and climbing Mount Kilimanjaro, which is one of the seven summits in the world. It's 19,333 feet, highest peak in Africa. And one of the gals that was on the trip, her name was Kirsty Ennis. And with Kirsty, she's a wonderful soul. She's an ex-Marine who is an above-the-knee amputee. So if you can imagine basically hopping up the mountain on one leg and summiting this thing, it was just amazing. And it was kind of the good news, the bad news. The good news is that everybody made it. The bad news is because she had this disability, it just took forever to get up there, understandably. And it just exposed a lot of people to altitude, you know, way too long. So where I'm going with all this is we finally get to the top and we're at the sign where it says you're at the top and we're taking pictures and high-fiving and hugging. And the next thing I turn around, Jim Moore and I turn around and Cory, he can't see out of one of his eyes. And Chris Long is completely delirious. He's about ready to fall off the hill. We grab him. Luis Castilla, he was coming down. We had to put him on oxygen. I mean, it was just chaos, you know, that ensued from all this high altitude, you know, illness. Another guy got pulmonary edema, and so he fell over. So there was a lot of crazy stuff that was going on. So the word which I'm leading up to is what you had to do is rather than sit there and complain about it and sit down like somebody did on me on Denali in a very dangerous situation this last May, what you did is just like, just help me get off the top and I'll be okay. That's all you said. Just help me get off the top and I'll be okay. So we, you know, help guide you off the top and some of the other people, and we did it. And the word that just jumped out to me, and again, something I've heard from you, I just want you to expand on this, is this word called grit, right? So when you hear that word grit, what does that mean to you?
It's interesting because it can be something that's passed over so quickly. But as I thought about it more, this was something that it's deep. It's kind of ingrained into this habitual place in your soul, right? This is something that's not given to you. It's not gotten overnight. This is developed over time and adversity and the people that have called it out in your life and a purpose that can be later defined. And it's the ability to keep stepping, right? It's to lean on other people. It's a whole lot involved in that. Some people call it perseverance. I had somebody call it discipline the other day, you know, the discipline to get up. But it's just this innate ability that you eventually develop from habit, from doing it over and over, because it's not motivation, right? Motivation drops in a day. And it's something that you just learn by putting one foot in front of the other. And all of a sudden, I'm getting up at 5 a.m. I'm going to the gym every day. I'm getting to work. At the same time every day, I'm getting up, getting baby girls' food taken care of every day. I'm making sure I'm there emotionally for my wife and for my family, and I'm leading them with intention and purpose. Right? It's a whole lot of different things. And that was, when you get to a point, all of a sudden it clicks where that habit, it turns into habit, and you find yourself in a situation like we're on top of a mountain, for crying out loud, right, in Africa at 19,000 plus feet, where you're not made to stay, and things are going wrong. You're going, I'm personally going blind in one eye that didn't come back for a day, and delirious as can be, like Chris Long is going. A lot of us were going like that.
Yep.
And all of a sudden it was just like, hey, all right, I'm thinking, I need to pull this thing together. I need to, and all of a sudden something clicks where I was like, I got to pull it together. I got a baby girl. I got my wife. I got, help me out. Right. And so I lean on you guys who are experienced, someone like you who's experienced and been on these mountains before, who's seen people in this situation before, and guys who are doing okay. Coach Morrow seemed all right.
Yep.
And he is, I love him. He's got a ton of fire. You know that.
Yep.
But that all of a sudden kind of that grit and that habit takes place where, okay, I know I can do this. Let me figure out how, right? It's not a matter of just sitting down and like I'm done, right? Because that's what I wanted to do when we got up to the crater. What's the Gilead? What's that point right there? That we made it at? What was it called?
Yeah, it's Gilliam's Point.
Gilliam's Point. We reached that, and I thought that was the top. Yeah. And it was like getting punched in the face.
I know. That's the false top. False summit, man.
But I wanted to stop, but I'm like, crap. Okay, give me a second. Let me compose myself. All right, let's do this. Help me out. I'm going to stick with you guys.
Yep. So we actually had to go about another half a mile around the crater to get to the top. And then even at the top, it was fairly warm. It was sunny, but it's just that exposure to high altitude. And, you know, I love what you said about grit, and grit is not necessarily something you're born with. It's something that you develop over time. And I think another thing that I've really felt and sensed from you is that comes, I think it's a cousin to grit, is because of those things that you talked about, it's your moral compass. It's knowing to do the right thing. It's knowing what you got to do to get yourself out of a situation or not putting yourself in a bad situation, right? That doesn't have necessarily anything to do with mountain climbing, but I think, you know, grit, integrity, moral compass, I think all those things are the things at least that I try to strive for and the people that I want to be around. And that's why I said, you know, throughout the entire trip, you know, when we were hanging out and we were out chasing giraffes and just having a good time, you know, when we weren't stressed and just, you know, all the different, I think we camped, you know, what, 5 or 6 nights going up the mountain until we summited. You know, you really demonstrated that in the right way when a lot of people I've seen that get stressed in those situations, they turn into other people. And it's just like, okay, the true character finally comes out. And, you know, you showed that through and through. And I, you know, I'm just very, very proud to call you friend and that you're made up of those things.
Well, I appreciate that. I just thought it was cool. To me, it was funny when we got the, I don't know about you, but when you got the first invitation, Chris, my first, David Vibora, who played with Chris Long, is how we connected. But talking with Chris, and then all of it, he's like, hey, you want to climb Killy and go try to raise some money and build some wells? And you're like, at first it was the Africa thing. Like, holy crap, I've never been there. Yeah. let's go do this. And I wanted to go do everything, right? I mean, shoot, we're throwing footballs on the top of the mountain, for crying out loud. I mean, before the elevation sickness kicked in, but
that was about 14,000 feet.
But we're throwing footballs around and we're experiencing a whole new way of living. I'm in this. Like, I want to be involved, right? I mean, I could easily be lazy and just sit back and not doing anything, but I want to be involved with you guys. And I loved it because everybody was jumping in on that. We had such a good group, I think, going up that mountain. And it was funny, you know, I'm sure. They were asking for your feedback too. And like, hey, how can we make this experience better? And my only feedback was go after the same kind of people. I really think the group, the mesh of people that we had together melded so well and worked so well. Nobody was offended by anything. Everybody was there just to work, right? And helped each other out. And I got I loved asking you questions because I'm like, what the heck, how does this compare to other summits? And then you're talking about Denali and some different more strategic climbs in reference to that and how they compare. And it was just the characters that were on board showed themselves really well.
Absolutely. You know, the other thing that really was impressive too to me was, so that was certainly one part of it. And the other part of it was, when we were actually in the tribes and the Maasai people. And, you know, I'm sitting here in Hermosa Beach and you're in Fort Worth right now and you're in your car. And I mean, all these things, they don't have any of this stuff. You know, they're as you saw, you know, their floors are dirt and they've got these sticks that hold up their house. And I've never seen a more grateful group of people. You know, it's all about family and it's all about gathering. I mean, they have no currency, or they do. The currency is a goat. You know, it's not like you run down and, you know, hey, I'm going to get some toothpaste. You know, they grab a leaf off a tree and they start chewing it. And it just puts thing again in perspective when we start to get a little bit like, I don't have enough, or I'm not doing the right things. I mean, they just have it nailed in terms of the simplicity of life is really, you know, the diamond jewel to their happiness. And I don't know. I mean, it's just something that I really took along. So we had a great group. That great group, you know, entered those tribes. You know, you were there, you saw it, and just, you know, how wonderful they were to us, and, you know, our appreciation back to, you know, the kind of life that they were living. So, I mean, I don't know. It was just really cool.
Well, and I'll put one thing out there. And before I went on this, because I've had other people go on mission trips, seen other friends do this stuff and raise funds for it, right, to help out other continents or other places we were helping. And I've had this attitude before, which is flipped now, because I know there's people out there, well, you know, why don't you just help our backyard? Like, we got lots of problems. Why don't you just raise funds or stick around here and help America, right? There's problems over here. There's homeless people over here. There's XYZ. And I was definitely one of those people questioning that until I got there to see it, right? Was we got there and you have a totally different experience. And what you're talking about, right, is the simplicity of the living. We're Skyping right now. We're Skyping, having this conversation on a podcast. And I do the same thing where I listen to podcasts for enjoyment and to get information, while these folks over here are waking up in the morning and the dad's telling the wife and the kids, hey, go find some water. By the way, don't get eaten, you know, or don't get raped along the way, because I got to find something to eat and we need to live.
Yep.
I mean, those are the legit everyday trials they're facing while I'm sitting here worried about how many grams of protein are going in my protein shake.
I do know that, because we're yeah, very similar to that. But, and, you know, yeah, go ahead.
But no, just like what you're saying, though, it was obviously a well and bringing water is a huge thing to them. But we showed up in these celebrations that were taking place. These folks are slaughtering 15 lamb to celebrate us doing that for them, right? And it was so great to see that. And it was funny because I don't even remember Jumbo was a greeting they had to say hello. And at first I totally thought they were calling me fat. And I'm like, Jumbo, who are you talking to, kids? Yeah. they wanted to touch you. They wanted to say thank you. They wanted to be a part of it. And it was just, you go outside of yourself so you can fully appreciate what you have here. Your family, I mean, not that it's about stuff, but you're like, holy cow, I'm driving a truck right now. And those people are walking miles a day.
Literally.
You know? Yeah. I'm like, I need to stop complaining about the garbage in my life that is not garbage and realize a whole lot of good that's there.
Well, again, we talked about this earlier in the podcast, but, you know, it's all about perspective, right? And, so, and that's life. And that's, you know, when you have to overcome certain things, and you've overcome, you know, your NFL career when you had to mourn that loss, and you've overcome knee injuries. And then you had unfortunately, your brother's son passed away from cancer. And I mean, absolutely devastating. I can't imagine, you know, going through that. And then you're trying to ask yourself, you know, how do I make sense of this? I don't know. How did you get through that?
That was hard. I mean, originally I'm middle of three boys. My younger brother Casey, my older brother Clay, we're all 3 years apart. And Casey and I were the sports guys, right? We grew up playing football and wrestling and doing everything together. And I remember us playing pool at dad's house. My folks were split, but playing pool at my dad's house. And for every ball the other guy would make, you'd have to do 10 push-ups, right? So I remember doing all that stuff with Casey. And so right after his son, Evan, and his wife, Ashley, I don't want to leave her out, but like after his first birthday, you know, found out he was diagnosed with a ATRT, atypical rhabdoid tumor, which is a 1 in 2 million chance of getting. And it's a crazy aggressive. And we went through the chemo bouts and went to St. Jude. And overall, it was about 7 months long was this period of a fight. And the heavy part for me going through that was that's when we were pregnant with Grace, was my daughter, our daughter. And the first time they met was at St. Jude Hospital in Tennessee when we found out that it was he only had so long to live.
Yeah.
And that's when the doctor said, hey, take your boy home and enjoy your time with him. And that is a brick wall that you cannot slam through. Right. And it was a time for me of complete, and not just me, but everybody in our family, of complete confusion. And it causes all sorts of fights and different things that go on of choices that should be made and how should people should act in certain situations. It's just, it just causes a whole mess of issues. And for us, that's why I say this, everything in my life and everything in my brother's and his wife's lives and ours were a preparation for this, right? Everything I'd faced in football, everything that I'd gotten through that injury was at a time to help me walk through it and to help support my brother when he needed it bad. And at a time where we couldn't make sense of a situation. And I remember sitting at St. Jude right after we got the news and we got to hop on a plane to go back. And I'm sitting here helping him take his rental car back. And we're just sitting in the truck, like right now, quiet, trying to make sense of this situation. And all I could tell him was how much he meant to me. You know, I couldn't find any words. And all I could sit there and repeat over and over again was how much I love him and how much he's my brother. And I want to be there with him. And I, you know, and it was hard. It was hard to do that. And, you know, ultimately Biggie passes and we just keep walking. And we know this, the effect that he has on our lives and on everybody else around him, because the communities that they just sucked on to Casey and Ashley and loved them to death. And that's why I say I love this value of grit, because you need people to develop that. And all of a sudden those people, like, we're on top of the mountain and all of a sudden, like, I know I can do this. I got to figure out how, and I need somebody to hold on to. Right. And I grab you, I grab Coach Moore, I grab Chris Long. And in this situation, I grab my brother, or you guys grab me to hold me up, you know, and I grab my brother to hold him up. And we try to make sense of a situation and keep walking and keep moving. And we walk into, and this is what I kind of a revelation to me was that value and those habits keep you walking long enough so that God can meet you where you're at and lead you into a better place. Yeah. And the best thing about that to me right now is they've done that. They've kept walking and it led them to a place right now where they totally think that, like, I know Big E had a place in this, but right now they're pregnant with twin girls. And it's like a breath of life. And I would say Casey's way better than I am, my brother, but you know, I'll be the emotional one, fly off a handle in a minute. But that value he had, and we had the people around us, was able to lead us or to keep us walking long enough to see the light that was right around the corner. Right. And he changed careers. He went into, now he's working with Seattle Police Department and he's finding purpose at a whole lot more level than he ever had before. He goes, I want to do this for Big E. I want to do this for Evan.
That's great.
Right. I want to create more of a change because I know he would be proud of me for it.
Well, I tell you something. First of all, thank you for sharing that story, the beautiful story. And you know, I've had these types of situations in my life where I've told people, like, when these types of deals, you know, pop up, the last thing you can do is not go towards that person, right? The best thing you can do is go towards those people. And I've said to people when I've called them up or I've been there in person, I've said, you know what? I've got nothing to offer other than my support because I can't make this thing
you know, come back, right? It is what it is. And over time, they've always appreciated that. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is, I was just interviewing a wonderful woman last week called, her name is Kathy Eldon, and she had this terrible tragedy with her son. Her son was 22 and was stoned to death in Somalia. You know, try to wrap your arms around that. Yeah, it was awful. And so I was asking her about it, and she said sometimes that the only thing you can do is actually go through it. And then once you do, when you come out the other side, you know, you can look back and appreciate those times. So right now she's appreciating the times. I mean, she still gets sad from time to time, but she's appreciating, you know, the life that he had for 22 years. And in the case of your brother, you know, this other inspiration has blossomed from it, you know, being in Seattle and wanting to become a policeman and that. So anyways, I appreciate you sharing that story. And you know, it's just, we all have some thing that we have to get over and get through in life. And it's just a matter of how you handle it. And you know, so what you said was so much value to me. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
It's good.
All right, Cory. Well, listen, where can people find you? I know on Twitter, you're a Twitter guy.
Yeah. Yep. You can go, I have social media, so you can go on Twitter and Instagram is at Cory Porcter. And then I have my official Facebook also is at Cory Porcter Official. So you can go on there, follow me. And I post some videos and some different things once in a while. And I act like an idiot sometimes, so you have to excuse that.
If anybody wants to find out how to do a good barbecue, a Texas barbecue, you want to start following Cory. And we're also going to post these things in the show notes. So we'll get that over. All right. Well, listen, Cory, thank you so much. You've been a rock star on this podcast. And I love talking to you. And I know we poke each other back and forth here and there on texting and things like that. And it's been, you know, just an awesome getting to know you from last year's climb. And, you know, and we'll continue to stay connected as we go forward. Okay.
Heck yeah, man. I appreciate it, Mark. Thanks, brother.
All right, buddy.